Good afternoon, excellencies, esteemed guests, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Maher Nasser. I'm the director of the Outreach Division in the Department of Public Information, and it is my great honor to welcome you to the United Nations headquarters in New York, and also to welcome Professor Umberto Eco to give a lecture entitled Against the Loss of Memory. Welcome to also all of those who are streaming live, watching on United Nations television this afternoon as well. Professor Eco is one of the greatest writers and philosophers of our time and hardly needs an introduction. However, please allow me to say a few words about a man who has spent his life investigating and writing about the nature of the human condition and divining meaning from language, text, and existence. Professor Eco wrote, and I quote, "Books are not made to be believed, but to be subjected to inquiry. When we consider a book, we mustn't ask ourselves what it says, but what it means." As many of you know, the erudite professor's work is not only the territory of scholars and graduate students studying semiotics. He is also celebrated in the realm of popular culture for his many works of literature, notably In the Name of the Rose, which was adapted for the screen and starred Sean Connery. Taken as a whole, Professor Eco's body of literary work gives birth to ideas, characters, and dilemmas that inhabit our collective consciousness and call us to recognize the evidence through which the world speaks to us like a great book. Today, we are eager to hear Professor Eco's thoughts on the loss of memory. Here at the United Nations, we are also keenly interested in the preservation of human knowledge, experience, and memory. The Dag Hammarskjöld Library, which is part of the Outreach Division, is named for an inspiring Secretary General, houses the collective memory of the United Nations as an organization. We rely on the library to organize and safeguard the millions of documents and critical information created by the United Nations since 1945. We're currently digitizing our records to preserve and make them easily accessible to future generations. The United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization, otherwise known as UNESCO, also established the Memory of the World program in 1992. The impetus came from a growing awareness of the perilous state of preservation of and access to documented heritage in various parts of the world. War and social upheaval, as well as severe lack of resources, have worsened problems which have existed for centuries. Significant collections worldwide have suffered a variety of fates: looting and dispersal, illegal trading, destruction, inadequate housing and funding have all played a part. We hope that our efforts are helping to preserve the memories of people from all cultures. Today, Professor Eco will show a short video about his latest project, Encyclomedia, which captures all the highlights of Europe's civilization from antiquity to the dawn of the third millennium in a vast interactive digital platform. Technology, while at times may seem to be the enemy of traditional knowledge preservation, it also offers unprecedented possibilities of presenting and preserving knowledge and memory in a comprehensive and interconnected way. It is worth noting that this lecture came about when Dr. Danko Singer, a colleague of Professor Eco, met the former head of UN Publications, a colleague of ours, Ms. Valentina Kalk, in Milano at the Università Cattolica. After her lecture on the future of publishing, they discussed how new technologies can be an extraordinary tool for expanding and preserving knowledge. From there, it seemed only natural to invite Professor Eco to speak at the United Nations. Professor Eco, as a global organization, we hope that this is just the first edition of the Encyclomedia, and that this project will be expanded to other regions to help preserve a global memory of our world, a treasure of secrets emanated by many minds, surviving the death of those who produced them or been their conveyors. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in warmly welcoming Professor Umberto Eco.
Yeah. Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have seen the short presentation just projected that the idea of this meeting was inspired by the Encyclomedia, a printed and online overview of the history of the Western world from the Big Bang up to our times. I am not here to review that endeavor because I rank among its authors, and I think it would be not too much elegant to review a sort of book to which I have myself collaborated. But the very idea of Encyclomedia is inspired to a conception of our historical memory, and it is on memory that I shall elaborate some reflections that are today of the greater interest, even though Encyclomedia never existed. I can only say that the seminal idea that pulled me and other persons to try such an editorial venture was the fact that few people know how much time elapsed between St. Augustine and St. Thomas, even though they studied in the high school or at the university, that both dominated the medieval philosophy. Well, between Augustine and Thomas passed 8 centuries, which means that they were separated by the same temporal distance that separates us from Thomas Aquinas. In order to make time evident through a spatial representation, we conceived at the beginning of our work a sort of continuous line that shows the presumable lapse of time, if not from the Big Bang, and thus at least from the death of dinosaurs and the birth of Jesus Christ. This line must flow through a long portion of space and time, while once arrived to the beginning of the first millennium, the time between Christ and us occupies a very microscopic length of our line, so that one is obliged to zoom upon it in order to have a visual representation of what happened in the last 2,000 years. At this point, one can point towards a given portion of history and discover, for instance, that some artists, thinkers, or scientists lived at the same historical moment, or even ask the program to say if, by chance, Goethe could have had the possibility to meet Napoleon. The program can tell you that such an event could have been chronologically possible, and if one points to all the hypertextual links, one can learn that it really happened. The whole operation was inspired by the persuasion that, especially among the young generations from both sides of the Atlantic Ocean, we are witnessing a lot of historical memory. Mass media are mainly interested with the present. It happens more and more than in Italy, young people, including many university students, when tested about facts concerning, let's say, the Second World War, do not know how to define historical characters such as Badoglio, Churchill, or Roosevelt, or think, as it really happened once, that Aldo Moro was the leader of the Red Brigades. Worse than that, they are unable to tell something exact about events that happened 10 years before their birth. Unfortunately, such a loss of memory is at work even in the scholarly world. If I consult an American book published today on some specialized topic, I detect that the bibliography doesn't go backwards beyond the 80s, which can be understandable for certain sciences in progress, dealing, for instance, with the Higgs boson, but it's whimsical as far as the humanities are concerned. I remember to have seen a book on philosophy where, at a certain point, a certain idea by Kant was mentioned at the footnote, read C. Brown, 1982. The text by Kant were considered too old to justify even a vista. Besides, many documents you can visit online, on the web, lack any date, whilst it would be important to know if they were elaborated in 2010, 2012. Any temporal depth is lost. A legend, and probably it's not a legend, says that at the door of a famous American philosophy department, the head hanged a billboard saying, "Entrance forbidden to the philosophy historians." And I remember my conversation with a friend philosopher asking, why should we know what was the logic of Stoics if formal logic made the normal progresses from their times up to now, and it is more fruitful to study a contemporary handbook rather than an historical reconstruction? I answered that first, if by chance the Stoics were wrong, it is important to know also the history of the past errors in order to avoid them, and that in order to understand Copernicus, it is crucial to know why Ptolemy was wrong, since Copernicus didn't start from nothing, but he started by criticizing the idea of Ptolemy. Second, to ignore the history of ancient philosophy, as of any other discipline, can help us not to invent, as we say in Italian, the hot water. And there are many contemporary scholars who waste their intelligence in rediscovering, by useless efforts, ideas that were expressed very clearly by an ancient thinker. And then, the old dictum, historia magistra vitae, history is a master of life, is more serious than it is commonly believed. Because if Hitler had read something on Napoleon, or at least Tolstoy's War and Peace, he would have understood that it is pretty difficult for an army to reach Moscow before the arrival of the winter. And if Bush had read documentary historical narrations about the British and Russian attempts to win a war in Afghanistan in the 19th century, he would have suspected that that country presents many orographic and social features that make very difficult to submit its territory. This diffidence about history was and still is a typical feature of many analytic philosophers. And let me quote an incisive synthesis of the problem that I found in Simon Critchley's Continental Philosophy, published in 2001. Continental philosophy, that is European philosophy, usually considers the conditions of possible experience as variable, determined at least partly by factors such as context, space and time, language, culture or history. Thus, continental philosophy tends toward historicism, where analytic philosophy tends to treat philosophy in terms of discrete problems capable of being analyzed apart from their historical origins, much as scientists consider the history of science inessential to scientific inquiry. And continental philosophy typically suggests that philosophical arguments cannot be divorced from the textual and contextual condition of its historical emergence. The problem that comes into play is that no culture, in the anthropological sense of the world as a system of scientific and artistic ideas, myths, religions, value, or everyday customs, can subsist and survive without a collective memory. Societies have always relied on memory in order to preserve their own identity, beginning with the old man who, sitting under a tree, told the stories about the exploits of his ancestors and the founding myth of the tribe. And when some act of censorship wipes out a section of a society's memory, that society undergoes an identity crisis. Let me now consider the opposite side of our question, namely the damages of an excess of memory. To remember too much can result in a tragedy. Jorge Luis Borges told us the story of Funes el Memorioso. And let me read some passages from Borges' short story. I come now to the most difficult point in my story, a story whose only raison d'être is that dialogue half a century ago. I will not attempt to reproduce the words of it, which are now forever irrecoverable. Instead, I will summarize faithfully the many things Ireneo Funes, told me. Ireneo began by enumerating in both Latin and Spanish the cases of prodigious memory catalogued in the Naturalis Historia. Cyrus, the king of Persia, who could call all the soldiers in his armies by name, Mithridates Eupator, who met out justice in the 22 languages of the kingdom over which he ruled, Simonides, the inventor of the art of memory, Metrodoro, was able faithfully to repeat what he had heard, though it be but once. With obvious sincerity, Ireneo said he was amazed that such cases were thought to be amazing. He told me that before the rainy afternoon when the blue roan had bucked him off, he had been what every man was, blind, deaf, befuddled, and virtually devoid of memory. He had lived, he said, for 19 years as though in a dream. He looked without seeing, heard without listening, and forgot everything. When he fell, he had been knocked unconscious. When he came to again to present, he was so rich, so clear that it was almost unbearable, and were his oldest and even his most trivial memories. It was shortly afterwards that he learned that he was crippled. Of that fact, he hardly took notice. He reasoned or felt that immobility was a small price to pay. Now his perception and his memory were perfect. With one quick look, you and I perceive 3 wine glasses on a table. Funes perceived every grape that had been pressed into the wine and all the stalks and tendrils of its vineyard. He knew the forms of all the clouds in the southern sky on the morning of April 30, 1882, and he could compare them in his memory with the veins in the marble binding of a book he had seen only once, or with the feathers of spray lifted by an oar on the Rio Negro on the eve of the Battle of Quebracho. Nor were those memories simple. Every visual image was linked to muscular sensations, thermal sensation, and so on. He was able to reconstruct every dream, every daydream he had ever had. 2 or 3 times he had reconstructed an entire day. He had never once erred or faltered, but each reconstruction had itself taken an entire day. He said to me, I, myself alone, have more memories than all mankind since the world began. And also, my dreams are like other people's waking hours. And again, toward dawn, my memory, sir, is like a garbage heap. A circle drawn on a blackboard, a right triangle, a rhombus, all these are forms we can fully discern. Ireneo could do the same with the stormy mane of a young colt, a smell herd of cattle on a mountainside, a flickering fire, and these uncountable ashes, and the many faces of a dead man at the wake. I have no idea how many stars he saw in the sky. He told me that in 1886 he had invented a number system original with himself, and that within a very few days he had passed the 24,000 mark. He had not written it down, since anything he thought, even once, remaining ineradicably with him. His original motivation, I think, was irritation that the 33 Uruguayan patriots should require 2 figures and 3 words rather than a single figure, a single word. He then applied this mad principle to the other numbers. Instead of 7,013, he would say, for instance, Maximo Perez. Instead of 7,014, the railroad. Other numbers were Louis Medlin Lafinur, Olimar, Sulfur, Clops, the Whale, Gas, Stew Pot, Napoleon, Augustine de Vedia. Instead of 500, he said 9. Every word had a particular figure attached to it, a sort of marker. The later ones were extremely complicated. I tried to explain to Funes that this rhapsody of unconnected words was exactly the opposite of a number system. Funes either could nor would not understand me. In the 7th century, he said, Locke postulated and condemned an impossible language in which each individual thing, every stone, every bird, every branch would have its own name. Funes once contemplated a similar language, but discarded the ideas too general, too ambiguous. The truth was, Funes remembered, not only every leaf of every tree in every patch of forest, but every time he had perceived or imagined that leaf, he resolved to reduce every one of his past day to some 70,000 recollections, which he would then define by numbers. Two considerations dissuaded him. The realization of the task was interminable, and the realization was pointless. He saw that by the time he died, he would still not have finished classifying all the memories of his childhood. The two projects I have mentioned, this is still Borges, an infinite vocabulary for the natural series of numbers and the pointless mental color catalogue of all the images of his memory are foolish, even preposterous, but they reveal a certain grandeur. They allow us to glimpse or to infer the dizzying world that Funes lived in. Funes, we must not forget, was virtually incapable of general Platonic ideas. Not only was it difficult for him to see that the generic symbol dog took in all the dissimilar individuals of all shapes and sizes. It irritated him that the dog of the 3:14 in the afternoon scene profile should be indicated by the same noun as the dog of the 3:15 seen frontally. His own face in the mirror, his own hands, surprised him every time he saw them. Swift wrote that the Emperor of Lilliput could perceive the movement of minute hand of a clock. Funes could continually perceive the quiet advance of corruption, of tooth decay, or weariness. He noticed, the progress of death, of humidity. He was the solitary, lucid spectator of a multiform, momentaneous, and almost unbearable, precise world. Babylon, London, and New York dazzled mankind's imagination with their fierce splendor. No one in the populous tower or urgent avenue of those cities has ever felt the heat and pressure of reality, of a reality as inexhaustible as that with battle at Irenaeo day and night in his poor South American hinterland. It was hard for him to sleep. To sleep is to take one's mind from the world. Funes, lying on his back, on his cot, in the dimness of his room, could picture every crack in the wall, every molding of the precise house that surrounded him. I repeat that the most trivial of his memories was more detailed, more vivid than our perception of a physical pleasure or of a physical torment. Off toward the east, in an area that had not yet been cut up into city blocks, there were new houses unfamiliar to Irenaeo. He pictured them to himself as black, compact, made of homogeneous shadow. He would turn his head in that direction to sleep. He would also imagine himself as a bottom of a river, rocked and negated by the current. He had effortlessly learned English, French, Portuguese, and Latin. I suspect, nevertheless, that it was not very good at thinking. To think is to ignore or forget a difference, to generalize, to abstract. In the teeming world of Ireneo Funes, there was nothing but particulars, and they were virtually immediate particulars. The leery light of the dawn entered the patio of packed earth. It was then that I saw the face that belonged to the voice that had been talking all night long. Ireneo was 19. He had been born in 1868. He looked to me as monumental as bronze, older than Egypt, older than the prophecies and the pyramids. I was struck by the thought that every word I spoke, every expression of my face or motion of my hand would endure in his implacable memory. I was rendered clumsy by the fear of making pointless gestures. Ireneo Funes died in 1889 of pulmonary congestion. Thus, leaving Borges, because of this unfortunate virtue, Funes was a perfect idiot. He couldn't act anymore. Now, if somebody believes that the World Wide Web can act to reinforce our memory of the past events, let's consider that the World Wide Web is already, or will soon be, similar to Funes's brain. Up to now, societies filtered things out for us through textbooks or encyclopedias. With the coming of the web, all possible knowledge and information, even the last useful, is there at our disposal. Hence the question, who is doing the filtering out? Last summer I was working at my countryside home without the 30,000 volumes I have in Milano, and I needed some data about, say, the Holocaust. I called up the web and I found an incredible amount of sites. Knowing pretty well the contemporary history, I was able to eliminate the cranks, the fanatics, the websites which only gave superficial information, and I was slowly able to select the, let's say, 10 sites which contained viable information. What will happen to laymen who for the first time searches the web for some elementary but feasible notions on the Holocaust? The inability to filter out entails the impossibility to discriminate. To my mind, to have 10,000 websites on the same topic is the same as having known, because one, and especially a youngster, is not able to select the important reliable ones, and even if one could, he or she will have no time to explore all of them. We have increased our memory storage capacity, but we haven't yet found the new parameters of filtering out. When confronted by the web, we have at our disposal neither a rule for selecting information nor a rule for forgetting what it is not worth remembering. One only possesses selection criteria insofar as one is prepared intellectually to face the ordeal of surfing the web. We need educational centers, schools, books, scientific institutions, some meta-web sites who will teach us how to select. A new art of decimation has to be invented. Otherwise, 7 billion inhabitants of this planet will produce 7 billion of different ideological selection procedures. The result would well be a society composed of juxtaposed individual entities, which seems to me a mark of progress, without the mediation of groups, which seems to me a danger. I don't know whether such a society would be able to function properly. Even in inventing something new, we need a common encyclopedia from which to start. The fullness complex obsessed mankind from the beginning. Since the classical antiquity, the problem of the need to forget appears contemporaneously with the development of mnemonic techniques by which to commit to memory the maximum amount of information, especially in centuries in which information was not as readily obtainable and transportable as it has been later with the invention of printing and subsequently of electronic devices. The classical example of mnemonic device consisted in imagining a complex spatial image, a palace, a square, a city, where there are architectural items or statues, many representing strange or terrifying facts, to which one could associate every kind of data, concepts, logical principles, events, and so on, so that by figuring out or visiting the place and remembering these images, one could remember a complete system of notions. But sometimes it was more difficult to remember the mnemonic images than the data to be retrieved. In De Oratore, for instance, Cicero cites the case of Themistocles, who was gifted with an extraordinary memory. When someone offered to teach him an ars memorandi, an art of remembering, Themistocles replied that his interlocutor would be doing him a greater kindness if he taught him how to forget what he wished to forget than if he taught him how to remember, inasmuch as he would prefer to be able to forget something he didn't wish to remember than to remember that he had once heard or seen. Themistocles tried to escape the fullness syndrome. The problem of the excess of memory explains why one of the terrors of the practitioners of mnemonics was that of remembering so much as to confound their ideas and forget practically everything as a result. It seems, in fact, that at a certain point in his life, Giulio Camillo, who in the 16th century invented an absolutely unfeasible theater of memory, had to excuse himself for his confused state and for the gaps in his memory, citing as an explanation his protracted and frantic application to his mnemonic techniques. On the other hand, in his polemic against mnemonics, Cornelius Agrippa, the same period in De Vanitate Scientiarum, claimed that the mind is rendered obtuse by those monstrous artifices and by being so overburdened is led to madness. Hence, subterraneously parallel to the fortunes of the ars memoriae, the reappearance from time to time of the phantasm of an ars oblivionalis, an art of forgetting. Thus, in 1592, a given Filippo Gesualdo wrote a Plutosophia, a method for oblivion, and in his intent upon developing an art of forgetting, he suggested the same techniques as an art of remembering. He recommended to imagine a theater of memory where usually were put different images associated to something to remember, and then either in the daytime with closed eyes or at night in darkness, you should go wandering with your mind through all the imagined places, evoking an obscure nocturnal gloom that hides all the places, and proceeding in this fashion and going back a number of times with the mind and not seeing any images, every figure will soon disappear. Oh, just as the painter passes over and whitewashes his paintings to cancel them, so we too can cancel these images with colors painting over them, and these colors are white, green, or black, imagining over the place white curtains, green sheets, or black clothes, and going over the place a number of times with these veils of colors. And one can also imagine the place stuffed with straw, hay, firewood, merchandise, etc. I consider an excellent rule to put in place new figures, because just as one nail drives out another, so forming new images and putting them in the place already imagined cancel the first images from our memory. Or imagine a great storm of winds, hail, dust, ruined buildings and place and temples, a flood that leaves everything in a state of confusion. And when this noxious thought has continued for a while and been repeated several times, finally go white, go walking among the places with your mind, imagining the weather bright and the calm and peaceful, and seeing the places empty and bare as they were formed by the first time. Or imagine a man with a style terrible and fearsome, the more cruel and bestial and belligerent the better, who with a troop of armed companions enter and passes impetuously among the places in which scourges, staves, and other weapons drives out the likenesses, assaults the people, shatters the images, pulls the fly through doors and windows, all the animals and animate persons who were in the place, until after the tumult has passed and the ruin, seeing the place with a mind recovered from its terror, they will be seen bare and vacant as before. Okay, we don't know whether anyone put into practice the artifices Gesualdo recommended, but we are entitled to suspect that all these stratagems made it possible not to forget, but to remember better what was the practitioner wanted to forget, as it occurs when lovers try to blot out the image of a person who has abandoned them, and the more they cancel, the more the countenance of the beloved vividly resurfaces. Another author, that von Sertori later cried a hawk against an excess of memory, was Nietzsche. In his second Untimely Meditation on the advantages and disadvantages of historical studies for life, he wrote about the capacity to sense things unhistorically. The person who cannot set himself down on the crest of the moment, forgetting everything from the past, who is not capable of standing on a single point like a goddess of victory, without dizziness or fear, will never know what happiness is. Even worse, he will never do anything to make other people happy. Imagine the most extreme example, a person who did not possess the power of forgetting at all, who would be condemned to see every word coming into being. And let me suppose that Borges, when inventing fullness, was thinking of these pages of Nietzsche. Such a person no longer believes his own being, no longer believes in himself, sees everything in moving points flowing out of each other, and loses himself in his stream of becoming. A person who wanted to feel utterly and only historically would be like someone who was forced to abstain from sleep, or like the beast that is to continue its life only from rumination, to constantly repeated rumination. For these reasons, if it is possible to live almost without remembering, it is generally completely impossible to live without forgetting. Or to explain myself more clearly concerning my thesis, there is a degree of insomnia, of rumination, of the historical sense through which living comes to harm and finally is destroyed, whether it is a person or a people or a culture. End of quote. One of the interesting things about this text is that, While these remarks seem to address the individual's need for survival, the emphasis changes to the need for a systematic forgetting on the part of a culture in general. This switch is of capital importance because once the impossibility of voluntarily forgetting what the individual memory has recorded has been demonstrated, then cultures present themselves as a system that functions not only to preserve and hand down information useful to today's survival as culture, but also to cancel information judged to be in excess. In order to preserve its identity, a culture must not only act as a stock of information, but also as a filter. The history of civilization is a sequence of abysses into which tons of knowledge went missing. The Greeks were already incapable of recovering the mathematical knowledge of the Egyptians. The Middle Ages lost the Greek science, all of Plato, except for one dialogue, and half of Aristotle. Some of these losses were merely accidental. It was a pity to have lost, let's say, Mesopotamic mathematics, if there was such a thing. Some were due to censorship. Some parts of the lost wisdom was in some way rediscovered late. But in general, the function of a social and cultural memory is to act as a filter, is not to preserve everything. It would be mad if a book on Roman history had recorded what happened to Calpurnia, Caesar's wife, after the death of her husband, which, by the way, was not a male chauvinist conspiracy, because history records what happened to Clara Schumann after the death of Robert, since Clara, during her widowhood, was still famous as a distinguished pianist, and moreover, there were many gossips about an affair with Brahms, so that her life belonged to the events that the culture judged important to record. My life was and certainly will be not long enough to give me the opportunity of discovering the structure of the solar system, Mendeleev table, Pythagoras theorem, English history and grammar, and to decide whether Darwin was right and Lamarck was wrong. That's why I needed institutions that filtered essential information for me, so that the core of my information about the solar system is more or less similar, if not equal in size, to yours. In order to achieve such a goal, a degree of cultural gregariousness is necessary. That's why we accept the filter that collective memory, history, and tradition provide. To filter doesn't mean to cancel. As a matter of fact, frequently society do not make us to forget what we know or knew, but they also keep us from finding out what we do not know yet. Thus it happens that the culture can perform various kinds of cancellation, which can range from out-and-out censure, the erasure of manuscripts, bonfires of books, damnatio memoriae, forgery of documentary source, and negationism, until forgetfulness out of shame, inertia, of remorse. How to react to both loss of memory and excesses of cancellation? How to decide when a percolation was necessary and when we should retrieve what was illicitly deleted. If we read Aristotle's Poetics, we find the mention of many tragedies which have not survived until our times. We do not know why these tragedies got lost, as well as the names of their authors. A naive hypothesis is that Sophocles, Aeschylus, and Euripides survived because they were the best ones. The best one, according to which criterion? By which inscrutable reason they were selected and entered the canon? Maybe marvelous lost tragedies were censured. Perhaps because of corruption and bribery, some Athenian authority ordered that Sophocles was performed more frequently than some of his unfortunate companions. I do not know if these lost tragedies can be found again in some place, as it happened with the Dead Sea Scrolls. But I know that there are specialized individuals, such as historians or archaeologists, capable of bringing many cancelled data to light. In such case, the collective memory retrieves these data and restores them to our standard encyclopedia. Sometimes, on the contrary, culture decides that these data can be useful for specific researches but are irrelevant for common people and leave them in some specialized Indian reservation, that is, in specialized encyclopedias. In this way, a major culture decides to put some information in a latency state. Exceeding information is or was, so to speak, deeply frozen, so that when it is necessary, experts can put them in an ideal microwave oven to revive them again, for instance, in order to decipher an old document newly discovered. The latency places are represented by the model of a library or the archive as the indispensable containers where wisdom can be revisited even though it was not revisited for centuries. Up to now, no encyclopedia and no library keep notes of all the soldiers who took part in the Waterloo battle. And imagine what a tragedy would be to oblige young students to remember by heart all these names, as they are obliged to remember the date of Waterloo battle and the names of Wellington or of Cambronne. Let's now suppose that a scholar succeeds in putting his hands on as yet unknown archives and finds the list of all the persons fighting at Waterloo. Only the casualties were 50,000. I don't know how useful can be to have all those names, but we could then move this data into a hyper-specialized encyclopedia. Thus we can go on having easily forgotten these names and at the same time to be certain that if we need them, we can find them in some latent repository. To which encyclopedia belong the texts of the lost tragedies mentioned by Aristotle? Until now, a specialized literary encyclopedia can simply record the datum that of these texts we know only the titles. What will happen if these texts will never be retrieved? For the very fact that there are good reasons to believe that they once existed, if Aristotle wasn't a damned liar, we will keep going in thinking that they could belong to a sort of maximal encyclopedia, even though belong to it only virtually and in an optative way. Thus, this maximal encyclopedia, if the term only lets us to think of something cuius nihil maius cogitari possit, something of which nothing greater can be thought of, like the god of Anselm of Canterbury, is a structure virtually accordion-like, which can one day or another be stretched ad infinitum. And this is not a little encouragement for the advancement of learning. Squashed between a weak memory and its maximal excess in the labyrinth of a purely virtual maximal encyclopedia, what could we suggest to our children who do not know what happened a few decades ago? The only solution for enriching our memory is to read. Reading not only enriches our memory, but also make our personal life a little longer. Let's think of a day or a week in which you have lived many, many events, all exciting, independently whether they were joyful or distressing. You will remember these hours of day or days as full of experiences, and you will have the impression of having had an abundant life. On the contrary, if you had hours or days when nothing remarkable happened, these days, deprived of significant events, will disappear from your memory. You will have the impression of not having lived during that span of time. I think that this is one of the reasons why men spent a lot of energy in order to retrieve the past things. If together with our personal reminiscences, we also have the memory of the day in which Julius Caesar was assassinated, of the Waterloo's battle, or even the fictional day when Romeo and Juliet died, and if we remember as a personal memory the trip of Hispaniola with Jim, Dr. Livesey, Captain Smollett, Lord Trelawney, and Long John Silver, at the end of our existence we shall have the impression to have lived very, very much, not only decades, but also centuries. At my final second, I shall remember not only what happened to me, but also the death of the dinosaurs, Poitiers battle, the instant when Madame Curie discovered the radium, and the magical moment when Dante saw the mystical rose. All these memories will be part of my existence. As a reader, I enjoyed such a long life that I cannot remember everything in a single moment, and I hope I shall have time enough to remember it by installments. In a world in which one is tempted to forget or to ignore too much, the reconquest of our collective past should be among our first projects for our future. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Eco. We have time, I think, for three or four questions. So if you'd like to address a question to Professor Eco, please raise your hand and press the microphone. And
it's not indispensable to ask.
Okay, we have hand from there. Please identify yourself and go ahead. Wait for the light to go red, then we can hear you.
Maestro, my name is Camilo López.
Maybe it's better if you stand up.
Oh, yes.
Please.
As part of my research, I research on semiotics.
Can you speak to the microphone?
Mike.
I research on semiotics, and I have studied how the Western musical scale developed since Pythagorean times, as well as how the syntactic expressions of the kinetic energy at the distance went through phases, which means when Pythagoras developed the scale, he said, well, this is how tones should be. Then it went through three phases, and the same thing happened with the kinetic energy and also with the concept of a distance. They all evolved through very similarly, and by studying how the older cultural and also social developments, I came to the conclusion that the mind-body link is actually our semiosis, which means everybody's trying to find the mind-body link, like a little something that people have somewhere inside of their skull, but I think it's just the way we communicate. I have found very little research advancing such ideas. Any leads you could suggest to me?
Is it a question or a statement?
It's actually a question, yeah. I have found very little on that kind of research.
The core of the question in three words is?
The work is on semiotics, on just establishing the mind-body links, which I think is how when we communicate, and when I say the way we communicate is in any other way, like the way we dress, the way we have laws in our countries, the way we use technology, all of that. To me, this is the mind-body link.
Well, the semiotics as the flow or be concerned with too many things, and probably also with that, which is an exaggeration. Anyway, the problem of memory is only one aspect of the general situation of communication in which semiotics is interested.
Thank you. Next question. Please.
Hello, Professor. Thank you very much for that. You spoke of the importance for creating knowledge and for thinking of abstraction, but you did not speak of the importance of analysis. And I wonder if you think this uncurated, call it the internet, this uncurated knowledge that we have, this lack of an encyclopedia, while harming our capacity for abstraction, may not, in fact, help our capacity for analysis.
If I, you remember that fullness was in hot waters just because the quantity of individual information he possessed stopped him from having general ideas. So that means, what is to have general ideas? From the beginning of the history of philosophy is to see an individual and to be able to cut a lot of elements from it in order to have a sort of skeleton that can be applied to every other individual of the species. The excess of information provided by the web is a way not to allow to reach the skeleton nature of a certain piece of knowledge. I don't know if I answered your point. If not, it will be for the next lecture.
Any from this side? Please, I'll come to you after. Can you make sure it's read first?
Thank you. Professor, sort of a follow-up to that last question. You've spoken about the need for a filter, but if you look
about
at...
About the need for filter.
You've talked in the past, in your lecture, you talked about the importance of the filter, but if you look at some of the cultural institutions that filtered data in the past, they also provided frameworks for valuing data. They provided frameworks in which data had value relative to other components of the data. Christianity is an example of such a framework. So how do you see the cultural filters of the future dealing with constructs like the World Wide Web also providing comprehensive frameworks for integrating that data?
But I think that I said that culture can delete for economical reasons. It's not important to know what happened to California. We waste our time. And sometimes for very criminal reasons, like when Stalin eliminated from a photograph the face of the comrades he sent to death, or the rewriting of times in Orwell's 1984. So there are many kinds of deletion. Some are positive, some are negative. So we have to consider the possibility of deleting. I would add that every kind of censure, as the one I just mentioned, are voluntary deletion, and in this sense they are always arguable. What is, on the contrary, more innocent is the involuntary deletion, by which culture forgets. To forget the life of Calpurnia was not the result of an act, a voluntary act of censure. It was a sort of inertia. People, step by step, let those information dropped that information. Nobody was mentioning Calpurnia any longer. Probably the sane relation is the unconscious one. Mm-hmm. Any time in which the relation is the result of a voluntary act, we are smelling a censure and a dictatorship, I think.
But let me build on that question. I mean, historically, what remains is usually the history of the ones who won. More or less, they cleared up the filtering that you mentioned, the deletion. The winner always makes sure that that's the story that remains. But today we have, for example, WikiLeaks, which is consumer-generated information Wikipedia, of course. WikiLeaks is another one. Fraudulent slip.
Let's distinguish.
Wikipedia, where everybody and anybody can actually edit information, update it, and of course this anybody can do that. And therefore, it's not in the hands of just scholars or a certain culture to filter. Is that going to change or offer the opportunity to maybe address this notion of collective filtering or deletion?
Wikipedia is for me a paramount example of the middle size of a standard encyclopedia. It is not necessarily is done by scholar. Wikipedia records the information about a given item, the kind of information that everybody could share. Okay, not too much specialized. They are the footnotes for that. This is an example of the standard encyclopedia. And the fact that it is continuously corrected by the users, but with a certain control from the central body, is just due to the fact that the standard encyclopedia tries to assess itself on a sort of platform. That's the platform. What is not mentioned in WikiLeaks, in Wikipedia, it doesn't belong to the standard encyclopedia, at least as far as the good items are concerned. Then there are, items of Wikipedia that say that this site is incomplete, we need a few, okay. It is a case in which there is some difficulty to decide what is the common average wisdom that everybody should share. So Wikipedia is a good example of the way in which a culture cuts and conserves.
There was a question from the gentleman here, but I'm wondering, no questions from ladies. All the ones who have asked, I want to give you the question and then you.
Yeah. Maybe the Mrs. Calpurnia.
We often try to have gender balance at the United Nations, so please, more questions. Yes, please. Wait for it to go red.
There is a lady down there.
Go ahead. It's not red? Okay.
No, I know very well that you are a patient book collector. And, Anatole France quoted, a Biblephile doesn't buy books to read them. He buys them because he has already read them. So what is, in your opinion, the role of the real ancient books you mentioned in your wonderful speech, and the role of the libraries, they should preserve these books?
But you are speaking of rare books collection, okay? Because it's your job and your pleasure.
Yeah.
This kind of sickness has only partly to do with memory, because sometimes a book's collection concern the physical status of the book, so it's an erotical affair in which the content is not concerned. They obviously if you open an incunable and you touch the paper and you hear that it makes crack, 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 and it seems produced yesterday, and on the contrary, it has 500 years. Well, this is a sort of shock for your memory, no? It is a sort of hallucination by a sort of LSD by which you are traveling five centuries back. But it's a sort of remembering very linked with the corporeal structures. It's a kind of memory. Well, if then you consider a collection of all the books as a storage of things to be remembered, okay, that's the social functions. But we were 2 days again at the Beinecke Library at Yale University. Okay, it is a repository of memories, but it's a very complicated affair. The old book in the library, it has to do with what I called the latency state. There are authors that are absolutely ignored today, and they are known only by collectors who have never read them, and they know only the title. And sometimes one goes to open those books and rediscovers something absolutely important. For the collector, there is another feeling, the same by which the young lady opens the prayer book of her youth and finds the dry flower inside. So there are many other elements linked with personal memories and so on and so forth. You are a rare books dealer, so I cannot but recommend the people to buy old books because he is opening a new bookstores in New York tomorrow.
And the last question, please go ahead.
Professor, you spoke about filtering of information so we can come down to the core and use it. But from the world of research, I know that with filtering comes bias. How can we avoid that? Who's going to filter for bias?
You say that from the point of view of research,
well, with filtering comes bias, so bias of information. So with filtering, we get probably biased information. Who's going to filter for what information we get from, you know?
But you spoke of research. In every research, obviously we are obliged to no, for every kind of research, which is always an interpretation of data, it is also a selection of data. So every book, be it on algebra, on the history of England, or the nature of flowers, is an operation by which something has been eliminated, something has been dropped, and something has been applied that made more and more evident. It is this way a society cancels and retrieves through the normal scholarly activity by which we continuously reinterpret the data. If you ask, on the contrary, for a criterion,
could I have a chance to ask the question, since Professor Eco had called on me, I thought?
He has been very generous with his time, and I think we really have to stop, unless it's up to him, but one more? Please, go ahead, and that's...
Rhonda Haubin, and I'm co-author of the book Netizens, on the history and impact of Usenet and the Internet. And I appreciate Professor Eco raising this serious question about what should happen with all the data that we get. And I would like to ask you, do you see a parallel with the printing press? And didn't the printing press give us a wealth of new data? And didn't society have to learn how to handle that data? And would you think that society succeeded in being able to handle that data? And does that give us any sense that, in fact, the society now will find a way to handle the new data that's being made available via the printing, via the internet.
Certainly, internet is providing us with an enormous quantity of data we ignored, but that increases our necessity to filter. If that was the question, every culture had to filter excess of information. Today, we are confronted with the internet that obliges us to be able to filter more and more. And the social sickness is the people is able to filter less and less. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Eco. Please join me in showing a great appreciation. Thank you.